We are going to get started so we can have as much time at the end for questions. I'm sure it's going to be a very good and robust discussion here as we finish up. But Dr. Robert Pappas received his PhD in physical chemistry from the University of Tennessee and BA in chemistry from Indiana University. He specializes in consulting, formulation, duplication, and analytical testing services for the cosmetic, personal care, flavor, fragrance, and essential oil aromatherapy industries. Robert developed the first aromatherapy course to be offered for college credit in the U.S., as well as a course on the chemistry of essential oils. He is the founder of Essential Oil University, which hosts the Essential Oil Chemical Reference Database, containing thousands of literature references and GCMS reports for almost any oil. EOU's Facebook page is one of the most followed independent social media sites concerning essential oils in the world. He is also the inventor of the stove still, a small-scale home distillation device. He has published many articles and has been a continuous source of inspiration and education for the aromatherapy industry for almost 20 years. Please welcome Dr. Robert Pappas.
Thank you. Well, thanks for that introduction. As you might notice in the proceedings, there are no reproduction of my slides in this, and that's because all of these myths are taken straight from my Facebook page, which is given there at facebook.com/essentialoiluniversity. If you go to the notes section, they're all there. So you don't have to take notes, unless you just want to jot down things that you want to ask questions about. But there's no need to write any of this down. You can always refer, go to there to get all. There's actually more details about each of these myths there. And I'm going to be adding more all the time because I'm only touching on 15 myths that are there, and there are a tremendous number more than that out there. So if I don't hit the myth that you would like to talk about, we might have time to add that to the end of the discussion if you want to ask the question about another myth. When they first asked me to do this and they told me that they wanted me to talk for 90 minutes, I was like, oh my, I don't know if I can do that. I've never spoken for 90 minutes before. I don't know if I can even stand the sound of my own voice for that long. So I'm going to try to stretch this out to maybe 60 minutes. I'm going to go through the slides as fast as I can so we have as much time to interact as possible, because that's really where the most benefit, I think, comes from, is from spontaneous interaction. I don't like to necessarily lecture to people and just go over, you know, bullet point after bullet point, but we got to get through the necessary stuff to present the material, and then hopefully we'll have at least 30 minutes to interact after that. So with that, we're ready to bust some myths? Okay. Now these are in order as they are presented on the Facebook page. They're not in order of most popular, most important, or anything like that. So the order has no significance to anything, okay? Myth number one, there's no such thing as therapeutic grade. Now, yes, I know you might have some problem with this. The truth is there are many therapeutic grade standards out there, okay? But they're all internal company standards. How do you know which one to trust? Are they tested by a reputable third party? Details disclosed, et cetera. Those are all things that you'd want to ask in evaluating whether this is a therapeutic grade standard that you can trust. But they do exist. There are several therapeutic grade standards. Is the therapeutic grade just a statement of purity, or does it also provide a meaningful quality statement? That's another issue to consider, because there's a difference between purity and quality, as you may be aware. If the quality statement is provided, who's doing it? Are they qualified to make a statement? How long have they been in the industry? How many different types of oils have they analyzed? What's their background? These are all kinds of things that that you may want to ask. So, in summary, a better response to those promoting a therapeutic grade would be to say, while many companies promote their own therapeutic grade standard, one should be aware that there is no universally accepted independent body that certifies essential oils as therapeutic grade. That's a fair statement, and it's true. Nobody can refute that. But to say that there's no such thing as a therapeutic grade is, you might as well say there's no such thing as ISO or there's no such thing as any standard out there. It does exist, and no matter if a standard or any grading system is done by a company or by an independent body, it's still going to be done by people. And people are subject to mistakes and errors and subjectivity, no matter if how independent or are isolated from industry they may appear to be. There's always influences that change how they perceive things and whatnot. So there's no perfect standard, but these therapeutic grade standards do exist. And I just want to kind of get people away from the knee-jerk reaction of saying there's no such thing as therapeutic grade, because there is. Myth number two, pure unadulterated essential oils with no synthetics added remain good forever. I don't know if you've heard this one or not. Probably have. Truth is, nothing lasts forever, right? We all know that. They may exist for a very long time. There's no question that oils, pure or otherwise, will eventually go bad due to oxidation reactions that are unavoidable, unless you could somehow store them in an oxygen-free atmosphere, which would be pretty much impossible. Even if stored in an inert atmosphere, the molecules themselves over time can react with one another. So that's something you'll never be able to stop. Citrus oils are especially prone to change and oxidation, degradation, and whatever you want to call it, due to the high levels of limonene and other oils as well that are high in monoterpenes are especially susceptible to degradation in shorter periods. It's true that some oils get better with age, but only to a certain point. Eventually, everything degrades with time. We've all heard that things like sandalwood, patchouli, vetiver, the heavier oils get better with age, right? And they do, for a while. We don't know what that limit is. Is it 10 years? Is it 25 years? Is it 100 years? Eventually, the oil will degrade. That's just, inevitable. There's a little inconvenient fact called the second law of thermodynamics that we all have to face. It's why we age, why we all will eventually die, why the earth must end. It's basically stating that everything over time heads towards maximum entropy or disorder. Can't avoid it. You observe it in everyday life. Things naturally tend towards chaos. You have to put work into maintaining things in order. Myth number three, true therapeutic lavender should have no detectable camphor. Any level of camphor would indicate a mix of lavender and lavandin. Have you heard this myth? No? Okay. It's not such a popular myth. I think it's more popular in the MLM crowd, but it is one that's been going around that I felt I needed to debunk because it's patently false. Every lavender pretty much has a little bit of camphor in it. I've distilled many samples of lavender in the laboratory myself, and they all have a little bit of camphor. It's true that lavandin has much more camphor, and if you adulterate with lavandin, then you'll see elevated camphor levels. But even the ISO spec has an acceptable camphor range up to 1.5%. British Pharmacopoeia listed at 1.2% max. The EOU standard is that camphor, borneol, and cineol should all be below 1% in a good quality lavender. Those are three of the negative odor aspects that in true lavender that you don't want high amounts of, that we wouldn't approve for purchase for any of our clients if any of those were significantly over 1%. If you want more information on these or any essential oil, on the details of the chemistry, you can log into the EOU Chemical Reference Database at essentialoils.org, and you can see peer-reviewed journal articles, or actually reports, individual breakdown, chemical breakdowns from peer-reviewed journal articles that will, you can see probably, I don't know how many references for just lavender you can pull up in there, but quite a few. And it's getting ready to expand, as I'll touch on later. Myth number four. I'm sure some of you have seen these kinds of things going around about the frequencies and vibration thing. Essential oil vibrational frequencies range from 52 to 320 megahertz. Essential oils have the highest frequency of any natural substance known to man and will increase the frequency of our bodies. Okay. This is pretty much a totally meaningless statement that can be very easily debunked if you just understand a little bit about quantum mechanics, which most people don't, which is why this myth is perpetuated for so long. From quantum mechanics, we know that the electromagnetic energy is typically measured by looking at the wavelength of electromagnetic waves, which cause various energy level transitions between quantum states. Okay, and these wavelengths can be translated to frequencies through a simple equation, which if you've had any chemistry, you know you're familiar with this equation, but it's basically the frequency of the electromagnetic energy is the speed of light divided by the molecular wavelength, or the measured wavelength, sorry. Molecules emit and absorb energy in various forms resulting from electronic, which corresponds to the UV invisible regions, vibrational, which corresponds to the infrared region, and the rotational energy levels, which correspond to microwave energy. It would be impossible to characterize an essential oil or even a single essential oil molecule as having a single vibrational energy frequency. Okay? The facts are that essential oils, even pure essential oil molecules, have many frequencies associated, many wavelengths associated with them due to, well, if we're talking specifically about vibrational frequencies, we're talking about the vibration of bonds, intramolecular vibrations, which the energy needed to cause those kinds of absorptions and transitions is in the infrared region, okay? And that region of the electromagnetic spectrum is 10 million to 400 million megahertz, way more energetic than this 52 to 300 megahertz. I don't know what this core, I don't even know what they're trying to say here. What device can possibly, I mean, I don't know, and I don't try to know, just, it's, if you see it, run away, that's all I say. Myth number five. Essential oils were used in biblical times and even found in King Tut's tomb. Well, it's true that aromatic materials were used in biblical times for various medicinal, religious, and ceremonial purposes, but these materials would not have been essential oils, not like what we are saying are essential oils. They weren't distilled, steam distilled products at that time. Most people attribute the discovery of true steam distillation to a Persian scientist by the name of Avicenna, you may have heard of, in the 11th century. Some people will say there's evidence of distillation, earlier distillation apparatuses that have been found thousands of years before that. But if you really read the research and dig a little deeper, they're making a lot of assumptions based upon a fragment of a pot or some small piece that's not even a complete apparatus and drawing all kinds of conclusions based on that. I'm not convinced. For one, you know, the ancient civilizations of Egypt and the ancient Greeks and so forth, they had writing, you know, they had written technology, so why wouldn't they have written details about their distillation, their steam distillations, if they did it. And there doesn't seem to be any evidence of that. The aromatic products used during these ancient times would have been a crude solvent extracted nature using fats and pressed oils and the like. It would not have been very concentrated. Not to mention that they're extracted products, which the chemistry of an extracted product is considerably different from a steam distilled product. And so any description of how people used oils in those days is not really relevant to the steam distilled oils that we have today. That's the main point. Myth number six. If you use a pure essential oil on your skin and it causes a rash, then it's just your body detoxing. One of my favorites. Yeah. Not only is this a hilarious myth, but it's also potentially dangerous because obviously if you're telling people if you have a bad reaction, you're just detoxing, then they're going to think, oh, I just need more of this to finish the detox process and get it done, right? So generally, you know, if you put something on your skin and you get a bad reaction, it's your body saying, stop putting that on your skin. A detox reaction is when it's a response to something being taken away from the body. Think of a drug addict when they come off the drugs and they're going through detox. It's that process of weaning itself off the thing that it was used to. So it's completely mischaracterizing any, it's not relatable to anything that would be remotely true. In the case of an essential oil on the skin, we're adding something new to our bodies that your body has no prior experience with. Any bad reaction could not logically be classified as a detox reaction. Sensitization reactions to essential oils can happen at any time, which is why it's best to use the oils in dilution and do a patch test before using any new oil. And I always tell people I would recommend using any oil in dilution, even mild oils like lavender or tea tree, because you just never know when a bad reaction could occur, a sensitization reaction could occur, even if you don't have it the first time or the 100th time. Eventually, it could happen. So why take the chance? And as I'll show later, I don't do it in this presentation, but I've done a video on YouTube which demonstrates that it's actually more effective to use oils in dilution than neat. Okay. Myth number seven: essential oils are the most powerful living substances on earth. They are the heartbeat of the plant kingdom, the most life-giving substances in the world today. Eels are the lifeblood of the plant, and they represent in plants what blood represents in humankind. Probably my all-time favorite. This is a myth that got started by one specific MLM, which I will not name. I just refer to them as Voldemort. Well, actually, I'm not supposed to mention that. You shouldn't say that, even that name, right? Essential oils are volatile liquids that are steam distilled from plants. They're a collection of relatively small organic molecules. They are not alive. Okay. Now, I have run into people outside of the MLM community who actually have told me that essential oil molecules are alive. If you believe that, I just want you to ask yourself, if you could survive being distilled at 212 degrees Fahrenheit for several hours and come out alive on the other end, I'd like to see it. The plant itself is dead when it goes into the still, so obviously the oil that comes from it is not going to be alive. The oils don't give life to anything, but this is not to say they don't help the plant survive. Okay? They are obviously, those plants that do produce essential oils, the oils are important to their survival in various different ways, from helping them resist disease, bug repellency, and so forth. The plants don't start producing essential oils until a certain point in their development. The oil doesn't give life to the plant at some point starts producing the oil. Obviously, if something's going to give, if A is going to give life to B, then A has to pre-exist B, and that's not the case with essential oils. It should be noted that most plants don't even produce essential oils, so, you know, there's only a very few percentage-wise of plants that even have essential oils, so that fact right there is kind of going against the kind of claims that they're making. Essential oils are an end product of the plant metabolism and are emitted by the plant, not acting as, not circulating within the plant like blood does in the body. So, you know, they're secondary metabolites, they're end products. And it's not so romantic to say that essential oils are the excrement of the plant or whatever, you know, would be analogous to a human secondary metabolite. It's much more pleasant to the ear to say that the lifeblood of the plant, right? But we don't need to candy coat these very valuable and useful products to make them seem useful. We just need to tell the truth and show the facts of the science, because the science alone will show that they are useful. But just because they're on the lifeblood doesn't mean these aerobics aren't, these secondary metabolites and those essential oils are not extremely useful or for the survival of the plant, as well as extremely beneficial to humans. Obviously they are. There's a picture of some oil glands in Roman chamomile to show, you know, there's no veins and oil circulating through the plant or anything like that. Myth number 8. The best quality essential oils come from the first pressing or first distillation of the plant material. Oh gosh, where do we start on this one? Pressing, first of all, is not an appropriate term for most essential oils, because most essential oils are distilled, except for citrus, and when citrus is done, it's pressed one time, not multiple times. And even if you're people saying this or using the word pressing as a interchangeable word for distillation, it's still inaccurate, because essential oils are only distilled one time from plant material. Some oils get redistilled after they're initially produced, but they don't redistill the same plant material a second time. Why? That just is absurd. Who would stop? You know, you have a distillation process that you have to start up with a lot of energy and to get the steam from the boiler, and you're going to distill for several hours, and then you're going to shut it down, let everything cool back down, and say, I wonder if I distill this plant material again today, if I'll get any more oil out of it. I finished the distillation yesterday, and the oil stopped coming, but maybe today there's more oil in there. That doesn't happen. You're going to continue the distillation. Any producer who's producing essential oil is going to continue distilling the oil until there's no more oil coming, or until they're satisfied with the quality and they don't want what's coming later, and that's it. Nobody takes that plant material and distills it after it's distilled once. Some oils get redistilled to remove trace components that give the oil a bad odor. Again, that's taking the oil itself and then redistilling it, or fractionally distilling it, or vacuum distilling it to remove these bad, like in peppermint, for example. We've probably heard of redistilled peppermint. They'll take it and redistill it to remove some sulfur components or some of the aldehydes that are on the top end that give it a bad odor for the flavor industry, or bad flavor. But I think a lot of the confusion comes from the way ylang-ylang essential oil is produced. You know, because we're all familiar with ylang extra, grade 1, grade 2, grade 3. And I think some guru leader of some MLM company who didn't want to do any research kind of jumped on that and just made his own assumptions about what was going on and said, oh, that's the first pressing of the ylang, the first distillation. Then later they distill it again in the second and third. And that's how that all evolved. It started in one specific company, I'm pretty sure, but I'm not going to again mention that company. As we know, Elang Extra 1, 2, and 3 refers to one distillation, but during the distillation, the first part that comes over is collected in a vat or whatever, and they collect it until it reaches a certain specific gravity, and they set it aside, and they call that Elang Extra. They'll start collecting in a different container and collect it till it reaches some characteristic value of specific gravity. That'll be the Elang 1, but it's all the same distillation from the same plant material. Then they'll get the Elang 2 and the Elang 3 in that way. Myth number 9. Essential oils are complex mixtures containing hormones, vitamins, minerals, and other natural elements that are the most oxygenating substances on earth. I think Robert Tisserand on his site also did a really nice article on this subject as well, which you should check out. There are absolutely no hormones, vitamins, or minerals in essential oils. And obviously you've been hearing this from people in certain facets of the aromatherapy world, but most common one is seems to be a growing belief that there's vitamin C in citrus oils, which is completely ridiculous. The molecules in essential oils are mainly mono and sesquiterpenes, which are hydrocarbons, and they're oxygenated derivatives, okay? There are many, many more carbon and hydrogen atoms in essential oils than oxygen atoms. A large percentage of essential oil molecules are hydrocarbons and don't even contain oxygen at all. When molecules do contain oxygen, the ratio typically ranges from 1 to 2 atoms of oxygen to, say, 10 to 15 atoms of carbon and 18 to 26 atoms of hydrogen. For the most common cases of oxygenated mono and sesquiterpene. So, yes, oxygen is in essential oils, but it's not a major element in essential oils. By far, it's carbon and hydrogen. Furthermore, the oxygen in essential oil molecules is bound oxygen. Okay, it's bonded, it's in a molecule, and not available to be delivered in the form of free oxygen radical or oxygen molecules. Of course, there are infinitesimal amounts of dissolved oxygen molecules in just about any liquid, but this is insignificant. Okay, so these aren't very oxygenating, meaning they're going to give oxygen to other things. Not sure where or how or why someone wanted to perpetuate this myth, but it is out there. Company Y is the only company in the world who sells pure or therapeutic grade essential oils. Now, we're not going to mention Company Y. Voldemort. But while finding good and pure quality oils may not be easy, there are a number of companies out there selling pure essential oils. Right? There's not just one. As a general rule, the farther down the supply chain you go, the less likely you are to be getting pure product. Most companies have no ability or no desire to do the necessary quality control to verify what they're getting from their supplier before they pass it on to their customers. So I always tell people, look for companies who do in-house and or third-party testing, as well as have experienced staff who know how to properly interpret the test results. That's a big factor there, how to properly interpret the results. In the end, for most people who don't have access to their own GCMS, it really just boils down to who do you trust. You know, that the only way to know for sure what you have is to do your own analysis, unfortunately. That's the only way to be 100% sure, and even then that can be challenging. But even if you're going to send a sample out to a third party, you still have to trust the third party. Always remember that pure doesn't necessarily equate with good quality. That's another thing. an oil can be pure as the driven snow, but can be total crap. That happens not infrequently. If things aren't distilled properly, the plant material is not the best quality, or a whole host of factors can affect the quality issue, but it could still be a very pure oil. Myth number 11. When you don't like the smell of an oil, it means your body needs that oil. Our bodies generally tell us when we need something or should stay away from something, especially when it has to do with things that can harm us. The ability to smell was probably among the most valuable of the senses to early humans, and those who had a good sense of smell, along with the intelligence to listen to their nose, had a competitive advantage for survival over those who lacked such ability. Right? So if you're the guy tasting the plant for the first time, you probably smelled it first, right? And if you smelled it and you thought it didn't smell very good, and you still ate it, then that's what we call thinning of the herd, right? And if you're the guy who stood around and watched the guy die after eating it, then you probably smelled it and said, I'm going to stay away from that. And maybe communicate it to your friends, or maybe not. This is not to say if we don't like an odor that it's always good for us, or that if we don't like an odor that it will harm us. But not liking the odor of an oil is certainly no indication that you need that particular oil. I think this myth was probably started by a company selling really stinky oil. Right? Because if you can convince people, hey, if you don't like the smell of this, it means you need it. So they smell it, ooh, that stinks. I must really need this. I'm gonna buy, give me two. Myth number 12, real essential oils without additives do not freeze because there's no water in them. If there's no water, the oil won't freeze. I don't know if you've heard this one, but it is one that has been circulating. Truth is, every essential oil will freeze, just as every liquid on Earth will freeze at some point. If you cool it to a low enough temperature, anything that's liquid will freeze. There are several oils that will freeze in a refrigerator. There's oils that will freeze in a freezer, and there's oils that are solid at room temperature even. I don't know if you're familiar with oils like Zadravitz, which is a solid at room temperature, or orris butter, which is also a solid at room temperature. These are distilled oils that, after they cool, are solids at room temperature. Many times when the temperature drops, we see crystallization of single components, and this is why the oil is solidifying, not because the whole oil is solidifying, but because certain components, which are, when they're pure, they're solids at room temperature. And at higher temperatures, they're able to dissolve in the essential oil. And so that they don't crystallize out at room temperature, but you cool it down and then you start to see certain components crystallizing out. For example, you could see menthol crystallize out in corn mint, peppermint. You could see thymol crystallize out in thyme. You could see cedrol in Texas cedarwood. You could see napatalactone in catnip. And there's methylthujate in the western red cedar wood oil, which is thuja plicata oil. And there's others. But this is a ridiculous myth that if something freezes, it doesn't necessarily mean there's something wrong with it. And there's a shot of pure menthol in crystalline form, or as we like to call in the EOU Breaking Bad laboratory, crystal menth. Myth number 13, the order in which you mix the oils in an aromatherapy blend changes the odor and makes a difference therapeutically. Now, I bet there's some people in here believe this. Raise your hand if you believe this. No, I'm not. Okay, the truth is, as long as you are mixing each oil in the exact percentage in each trial, the order of blending of each component would almost never reveal a significant effect. That's the key, which most people don't have the ability to do. In order for there to be a real blending order effect, there would have to be a chemical reaction which takes place at each stage of the blending to cause such a difference, okay? That's what you're saying. If you say order matters, you're saying there's some kind of chemical reaction that happens when I add A to B that doesn't happen if I add A to C and then add B. That's what would have to happen. When people do claim to notice differences in these blends based on order of component addition, it's typically because they don't have the ability to conduct the experiment with quantitative accuracy. Okay? Most people are formulating with drops. I don't care what dropper you use, if you use the same dropper for every oil, that is the least accurate way to do anything in formulation. If you're going to do it right and you want consistency, you really need to do it by mass, and it needs to be done on a digital scale that goes out to at least a hundredth of a gram. When I formulate, I go out to a thousandth of a gram. But if you're not doing it by mass on a digital scale, you will not get consistency. If all the components are added to the blend at exactly the same amount each time, then the odor and the chemistry should be identical each time, regardless of the order in which they were added. And I did this is a graph of an experiment that I did where I did a frankincense, tea tree, and lavender. This is two different trials with different orders. And I expanded one graph so it was taller than the other and overlaid them so you could see every peak, and this is just a section of the whole chromatogram, but every peak matched up identical to the one before. So the blue line represents one trial and the black lines represent another. I don't know if you can quite make that out. And I did a little video about this, a short video, which is on my YouTube channel under EO Doctor is my YouTube channel. You can also just search under my name, Robert Pappas, and you'll probably find all the videos. But this is just a short little video I did to demonstrate to people that the blending order doesn't matter. Thousandths of a gram, and every component was added to within the error of that last component. There was might have been a little bit of variability, but that's an insignificant amount of error. And so each component was essentially 1 gram, almost exactly. And there's no difference in the order. Now, that's not to say if you did something unusual in your blending where you blended two components and then waited several weeks and then added another component or put it in some hot condition and then added the third one and then didn't do it exactly the same way as you did the first one, you might see some differences. But if you did each blend exactly the same way and the only difference was in the order and you did it the same time frame and all that, all the other variables were the same, blending order doesn't matter. Number 14, the FDA has determined that a product need contain only 5% essential oil in order for it to be labeled as 100% pure. Not sure where this myth, why anyone would ever think this is true, but there's a large number of people that actually believe this. The FDA has not made any such determination concerning essential oils. This statement in various forms, depending on the source, you'll see it ranging from 2 to 10% being claimed, seem to be originating again from a well-known MLM. Again, I won't mention any names there, but this doesn't mean, it doesn't make sense that a company would even try to make such a claim because it would be kind of suicide to do so. It would be very easy to test an oil to see that it only had 5% essential oil in it. And then, the FDA couldn't be a part of allowing such a thing. There's not really much else to say about this one. It's just false in every form that's reported. It's one of the statements what I call the crazy uncles type statements. Okay, we all have a crazy uncle in our family who kind of says crazy things, and we just kind of take it with a grain of salt. So this is This is the SNL. If you watch Saturday Night Live, this is a little picture from of the guy who plays the drunk uncle, whatever. Myth number 15. A synthetic molecule is different than the same molecule made naturally. That's right, I said it. That is a myth. Now, I bet there's a number of people that believe this myth. But let's dive into this. Now, if you... yes, feel free to stand up. By the end of the presentation, I hope to convince you otherwise. Okay, hard for many people with no chemistry background to accept this, but it is a myth. Molecules are three-dimensional structures of bonded atoms. Okay, the unique structure is what defines each unique molecule, not the pathway by which it was made. Molecules behave the way they do because of their structure. They have no knowledge of what synthesized their structure. If we are talking about the exact same structure, then the molecule will behave in the same way regardless if it were made by a chemical manufacturing plant or a peppermint plant. Okay? Isolated individual molecules of a substance are the same regardless of who or what synthesized them. But this by no means means that essential oils can be reconstructed molecule by molecule in a lab. Okay? This may cause some of you a crisis in conscience, but it doesn't mean anything different about essential oils or how special they are. And I'm going to show you why. Okay? Because it's not that the molecule is different. It's that the complexity of the oils, that's where the difference is. Complexity. And I'm going to kind of, this is an important one, so I'm going to spend more time on this than any other myth. Essential oils are almost always a collection of hundreds of molecules when you look at all the minor and trace components. The problem becomes infinitely more complex when you consider that almost every one of these components has an enantiomeric form to worry about as well. I'm going to talk a little bit more about what an enantiomer is and chirality in a minute. So the thing to take away from this is there's nothing magical about a molecule simply because it's made in nature, which I believe is meaningless anyway, because what is natural? I mean, you can't really separate man from nature. The magic, if you will, in essential oils is in the complexity and variety that happens when plants construct their molecules that humans in a lab cannot even come close to reproducing. So, I'm going to go in a little deeper here. What are organic molecules? Again, these are three-dimensional objects or structures in space. And these are kind of our helpful tools, models that approximate these structures. The black balls represent carbon atoms. The white ones are hydrogen in these structures here. But just to give you an idea, there are spatial considerations here that determine how molecules work in living systems. Can organic molecules be exactly reproduced in a laboratory? Yes. We can exactly reproduce specific molecules that are in plants. For example, from rose, things like citronellol or phenylethyl alcohol, etc. We can, in a laboratory, make these exact molecules. So why can't we reproduce essential oils in a laboratory? This is a very complicated, and could spend a whole course on just this subject. And it has to do with complexity and chirality, enantiomers, which I've represented there by the two hands of most molecules in essential oils exist in two or more forms. They have an L form and a D form, which you may have heard a little bit about. And basically, it's a right-handed form of a molecule versus the left-handed form of the molecule. I'm sure most of you know about amino acids in our body. They're all the L form of the amino acid, right? But there is a D form, which is a mirror image of that molecule. It's the same molecule in every way in terms of its boiling point, melting point, all the physical characteristics. They differ in the way that they rotate light, plane polarized light, and the way that they interact in the biological systems. That's the way they differ. So let's look at complexity. If you look at typical analysis from any number of companies of patchouli oil, for example, they may report 9 or 10 components, which might represent 90% of the oil or better. If you take that same sample and you dig a little deeper at a more typical level of analysis, you might see a report of maybe 22 components. And to get more components out, all you're doing is changing the threshold at which you're integrating those components, right? So you can set that number at whatever level you want, how deep you want to go. And if you go further, now we can see 95 components. You know, but how low do you want to go? And, you know, who wants to know every peak down to 0.01%? Most people don't want to see all that. They want a one-page report that shows the main stuff, and that's good enough. If you go even further, we can see 165 peaks. Same sample, just changing the integration level. It's all done. And if you could go even further if you had more sense. If you did an injection, say, without a solvent or with higher injection volume, you could see probably 300 peaks. Who knows? But that represent, you know, those 22 peaks probably represents 98% of the oil. So this brings us, that's the complexity issue. Imagine trying to synthesize each one of those molecules and not only get the percentage right on the surface, but then now we've got to consider this, the chirality of each of those molecules. Which ones have enantiomers? Most of them will. And the plants, unlike most synthetic processes in the laboratory, the plants will preferentially produce one enantiomer over another. For example, let's say linalool in lavender oil, right? The lavender plant produces, say, 99% L-linalool. If you make linalool in a laboratory synthetically from petrochemicals, you're going to get a 50-50 mixture of L and D linalool. Mirror image, same molecule. Well, they're mirror images, but as with any mirror image, if there's asymmetry, when you try to superimpose that mirror image on top of itself, you can't do it. So they're different molecules, even though they're the same in every other respect in terms of all their other physical constants. They will just rotate light differently, and they'll interact in biological systems differently. And that oftentimes is apparent by odor differences. So L-linalool smells different than D-linalool. L-menthol will smell different than D-menthol. L-carvone is a great example. L-carvone is the odor of spearmint, right? D-carvone is dill. It's a pretty drastic difference. And that's because of the way those molecules fit into those receptors in our nose and how they're translated to our brain. So chirality is a major, major factor. So again, trying to manipulate that would be an infinite project to try to get each one of those hundreds of components right and enantiomerically correct, because each one of those peaks on that graph doesn't even show its enantiomer, because you have to have a special column to separate out the enantiomer. So you could theoretically have two peaks for every one of those peaks that was shown there, or more. Chirality and enantiomers, what does that mean chemically? Okay. Try to explain this as simple as possible, but it can get quite complicated. Any carbon atom that is not involved with multiple bonds, i.e. double or triple bonds, has exactly four atoms attached to it. Okay? When the four substituents are all different, then you have inherent asymmetry or chirality, which allows the creation of non-superimposable mirror images. So go back to the picture there. This is the general formula for an amino acid. And each amino acid differs only by that R group, so that R is just a general group that varies from whether it's arginine or whatever, you know. It's going to be a different R group there. And if you look at those, if you take the same group, let's just take L-arginine, for example, it's an enantiomeric form D-arginine, and if you look at the other substituents, you see there's four different, look at the carbon atom, and you see there's four distinctly different groups attached to that carbon atom. That is the condition you need to have an enantiomeric form. So let's look at a specific case of chirality. And let's take menthol from peppermint, for example. This is a great case because it has three of these asymmetric carbon atoms, these chiral carbon atoms. And if you flip this, if you imagine flipping this molecule over and looking at it three-dimensionally, this is what it really, a more accurate picture of it would be. Where it took the oxygen, now it's over on the other side. The red atom is the oxygen, the whites are the hydrogen, and the blacks are the carbon. In the previous structure, we're not showing all the hydrogen atoms. This is a very crude drawing of what we call a skeletal structure that doesn't show all the hydrogen. This is a three-dimensional structure. So we have, I'm glad I have this pointer. The three chiral atoms are there. You see, we have hydrogen here, we have an oxygen here, we have this carbon group on this side and a different carbon group here. That's four distinctly different substituents to this carbon, so that's an asymmetric center. And if you look at this carbon atom, you have a hydrogen, you have this group here, and you have this group here, and this group here, which is different because there's an oxygen here, no oxygen over here, so that's an asymmetric or chiral carbon. And then you have this one here, which you have a methyl group, and this branch here, which goes down to the oxygen, and this branch here, which doesn't have the oxygen, and then a hydrogen. So one, two, three points of asymmetry. So what does this mean when you do all the math? You get four basic menthol structures, and then each of those structures has a mirror image for a total of eight isomers. And that's just for menthol. And all of these are present in peppermint. So again, trying to reconstruct this synthetically in a lab would be virtually impossible because the plant produces almost all L-menthol of the one we're calling menthol, almost no D. And then each one of those other isomers is preferentially either plus or minus L or D on down the line in very distinct percentages, where in a lab you'd be producing each of those at 50-50 ratios. So multiply that out by, you know, the hundreds of components in peppermint oil, and you can see how complex the problem is. That's the real complexity of essential oil that makes it different than a synthetic. Or, you know, it's not in the individual molecule being different from what someone can make in a plant, or in a chemical plant or a laboratory. It's in the overall complexity of the oil that can't be reproduced in a laboratory. And why is this important? Because if you understand these concepts, you can get a better quality control and ability to detect impurities, higher therapeutic value in selecting the more complex oils, and in general sense, the more complex the oil, the better odor quality it's going to be. Well, that concludes the 15 myths that are on the Facebook page. Future myths that I thought I might throw out there, which I haven't done yet. One drop of essential oil will cover every cell in the body with 40,000 molecules. And then perhaps I might do one on, you know, people that claim they can determine a purity of an oil with muscle testing. The one drop thing, this is one I definitely am going to do. This will be probably the next myth that I go into detail on the site. And it's not a myth for the reason you might think. How many people think that there are enough molecules in one drop of essential oil to cover every cell 40,000 times? Who believes that? Good man. It's actually much higher, as we'll see. There is enough. If you do the math, and I've done, because I always, this is what I do. This is what I do for fun. Okay? The estimates are that there's 30, somewhere between 37 and 70 trillion cells in the body, depending if you go by volume or by mass. Okay, let's take the high end of that. Let's take the 70 trillion number, which is 70 times 10 to the 12th power. Okay, that's a 70 with 12 zeros behind it. And the average drop in the, let's see, the smallest dropper is about 0.02 grams. I want to consider the smallest drop so that we could be on the other end so we can get, you know, the most extreme conditions. And let's take a lighter essential oil that's like a citrus, let's say almost all monoterpenes, which is going to have, the molecule is going to weigh an average mass of 136 grams per mole. And if you do that math, you'll see that one mole is 136 grams. You multiply that by 0.02 grams per drop, and you get 0.00147 moles per drop. And if you don't know what a mole is, it's just a number, like a dozen or any other. It's just, in chemistry, it's a name for a very, very large number. It's called Avogadro's number, okay? So then you come down, you say, okay, I got 0.00147 moles per drop. I'm going to multiply that by Avogadro's number, which says there are 6.022 times 10 to the 23rd molecules per mole. Moles cancel, and you get 8.86 times 10 to the 19th molecules in a drop of oil. Okay? Now, you take that number, 8.86 times 10 to times 10 to the 19th molecules, divide that by 70 times 10 to the 12th cells, and you come up with 1.26 million molecules per cell. The numbers are actually underestimated, so where is the myth here? Where is the myth? Anyone want to guess where the myth is here? Right. How do you get one drop? Are you going to take one drop of oil and you really think that drop's going to make it to every cell in your body? That's kind of ridiculous, isn't it? So it's not in the numbers, and I don't know, I guess people just thought this sounded impressive, so. But this gives you an idea of how ridiculously small molecules are, right? And to further illustrate that, I always tell my students, imagine if you had a thimble full of water, just a thimble, and you could count every molecule in that little thimble. Did you know that there would be more molecules of water in that thimble than there are grains of sand in the entire earth? If you counted every grain of sand from every beach, every desert, every underneath, looked in every nook and cranny in the earth and counted all those grains of sand, it would not equal the number of molecules of water in that thimble. How do we know that? How could you prove that? It's really an easy thought experiment to prove. You basically just, and I've done this, because when my undergraduate chemistry professor told me this, I went out and actually did it to prove it to myself, because I just blew my mind away. So I weighed grain of sand, took the average weight of a grain of sand. You can go to a beach and get some sand and weigh a grain of sand. And then you could figure out how many molecules are in that thimble. Let's say it's 5 grams or a gram or whatever it is. And you can figure out how many molecules of water are in that thimble. And then you can multiply that number of molecules times the weight of a grain of sand. And you see that the overall weight that you end up with is drastically more than the weight of the earth. So we know that. We have a good estimate of the weight of the earth. So that, you know, obviously that means there has to be more molecules in that than our grains of sand in the earth, right? The other myth, it's possible to muscle test to determine if an oil is pure or not. I would say no one in the world can muscle test to determine if an oil is pure, despite what they might claim. And if you think you can, I'll be happy to construct an experiment with witnesses to show you that you can't, but be prepared to be embarrassed in front of a lot of people, because I'll make sure that we do it in front of people. Finally, I want to tell you about the database. the new database that's going to be launching at essentialoils.org, or you can also now get there by essentialoiluniversity.com. In October, it's going to have a completely new look, new format, more information, more reports, more oils. And once we get that up and running, I'm going to have an iPhone app to follow that, that you'll be able to download. And on your phone, you'll be able to pull up any oil and look at chemistry and chemical breakdowns and whatnot. Finally, I have one last thing that I wanted to share just as kind of a humorous thing, because my people that work with me know how irritated I get with a lot of these myths, and many times I'll be working in my office and they'll hear me yell out, "What the blankety blank?" And they'll come rushing in and, "What happened?" And I'm like, "Oh, it's just like these people saying this stuff, it just drives me crazy." And so they know how I complain about it to them. And so some of my guys got together with some of the employees of my brother's company. My brother owns a large wholesale essential oil company, which I'm not going to name because I don't advertise for anybody, not even him. But they got together and they made a video that's, now don't be offended by this video. This video was directed at me to sort of, because they know how much these things irritate me. So they made this video and they gave it to me for Christmas. This was my Christmas present. And I'd just like to acknowledge, if you might have recognized, Prabodh Satyal was in that video, who's my senior chemist and a guy that has really been a benefit to me. And I hope you get to see his presentation. He's a superb chemist, and him and my other chemists that in my lab are what allow me to go out into the world and be able to go visit these places and do the research that I do outside of the lab. Without them, I couldn't even begin to get everything done that I need to get done. So I owe them just a huge debt of gratitude. Thank you.
We do have about 10 minutes for questions, but first of all, was there anybody else out there checking on Robert's math as he was going through that, like I was?
Checking on what?
Your math.
Oh, yeah, please check that.
Questions?
Oh, hello, and thank you for making us laugh so much.
Oh, you're welcome.
My question is, how do you know, you talked about being able to muscle test, which I guess is, like we saw, how would you test the purity and with what and for what would you look for in that doesn't belong there?
How do I test?
Yes, and okay. What would you look for?
Well, when you do, mainly it's through GCMS. That's the primary method. We do several other supplemental tests as well, but GCMS, looking at not just the main peaks, but you have to look at a lot of the minor peaks. And Prabodh's going to talk a lot about that, doing trace analysis of markers that arise from synthetic processes that don't occur in plants. That's one way. Chirality, we do chiral testing, which I didn't talk about here, chiral GC testing, so we can look at, like, say, the linalool peak in a lavender oil, we can look at that and then divide that on a chiral column. You'll see it split into two peaks, one for L, one for D. And if we see above a certain percentage of D, then we know that there's been some synthetic linalool added or linalool acetate, same principle there as well. Things like that. And then we do optical rotation, specific gravity, refractive index. Sometimes we have to do carbon-14 testing when necessary, but not always. So it's a pretty in-depth. But we do a good job at it. I think as good as any. I've been doing it for a long time. Looked at, hundreds of thousands of samples.
Other than for money, what do you think the underlying purpose of the recent push for internal use by companies has been? What do you think is behind
that?
Well,
I think at the top of, you know, at the root level of someone who might own a company that perpetuates that, there may be that in mind, but I think a lot of the reps don't necessarily have that in mind. Maybe some do. Obviously, if you're using them internally or if you're using them neat, you're going to use more oil and consume more oil, and so that is obviously a potential motivating factor. But other than that, I think some people just have a true belief in it, you know, because it's the only thing they've been taught. It's the first thing they were taught. It's the only thing they know. And when people try to explain to them the pitfalls of doing these, you know, some of them can't hear it because it violates what their guru may have told them.
As far as how what you were talking about, essential oils don't last forever.
Mm-hmm.
When I first started studying essential oils some 8 years or so ago, I had to buy every essential oil that I smelled. So now I have a ton of essential oils, many that I hardly ever use. So how do I know if they're still good? What to do with them? Do I just toss them down the drain?
Well, generally, if it still smells good and true to the oil, then it probably is. But oils will last longer than most people think. Most companies will just say, you know, 1 year expiration date, whatever. But just like any industry, the expiration dates are really there to protect them from anything, not necessarily when the product really goes bad. But generally, if you want to prolong the life of your oils, you want to minimize the airspace in the container. That's the primary thing. So when it gets about half full, you want to transfer it to a smaller container. Because oxygen is the biggest enemy. Not as much heat is not so much of the enemy as oxygen. If they haven't been opened at all, then you know, it just depends on the oil and how long it's going to be good for. But many years. I mean, I actually have a sample of lavender from 1945 that is still smells reasonably good. You know, because it's in a very small vial and doesn't have a lot of airspace in it. And,
thank you, Rob. I just have three comments. One is that I have to take responsibility for saying that essential oils are the lifeblood of the plant. So I just want to confess. I just want to take this moment to confess my sins on that. And I'm not proud of that, but you'll see it in my book, The Art of Aromatherapy, which came out in 1977. Secondly, when I said I disagreed that a synthetic molecule is identical to a natural one, that half of my argument you then went on to explain about chirality.
Right.
And so that was half of my argument.
Yeah, that's the point that most people miss. The L is not the same molecule as the D. They're distinctly different molecules. But if you're comparing L to L,
right,
then it's, yeah.
Yeah, but there is another part of my argument, which is that that's true in theory. But if you buy citronellol, you're not buying 100% citronellol. You're
correct.
Buying 98% maybe.
Correct. Mm-hmm.
And so there are impurities in the synthetic that are not in the essential oil.
Yes.
It has a different set of impurities, if you will.
Yes.
So I would say in practice, they're not identical.
Well,
even though they are.
My point was, if you isolate a single citronellol molecule, that's what I'm trying to convey to people. If you isolate a single citronellol molecule from the synthetic source and compare that to a single citronellol molecule from the natural source, and it's L-citronellol in both cases, they're going to be identical and behave exactly the same in every situation.
Sure, but we don't have a way yet to make 100% pure citronellol.
Correct, that's right. But I want people to understand why there's the difference and not have this false belief that somehow the pathway by which individual molecules are made somehow makes them different. That's okay. All.
Okay. And just finally, perhaps another myth for you to look at is I heard someone, or I read somebody saying on LinkedIn that they could smell the difference between an organic oil and a non-organic oil.
So that's a good one.
Just a suggestion.
That one, okay, if that's a real myth out there that people believe, then I'll jump on that one.
Thank you.
I have a personal question.
Okay.
And it might be what everyone is wondering. What is your favorite essential oil?
Oh, gosh. I'd have to say, at this point in time, I'm really in love with an oil called Damiana. I don't know if you've heard of it. Most people probably have never heard of this oil. If you have had experience with it, it's most likely not the true Damiana. There's really only one source for it in Mexico. And if you haven't seen it or would like to see it, it's an amazing oil. It's one of the naturodesiacs. That's the term I like to use for it. That's one problem. That's not why I like it, by the way. It just smells really good, and it's also an anti-anxiety oil. I think people have used it in ADD applications and some other applications as well. I'm sure it has many more to be discovered. It has components in it that we haven't even identified yet. And if you put this oil on a strip, it smells great at first, but when it really smells the best is after the top notes have kind of gone away and you get to smell this rich, deep notes that linger on a strip. You can come back to the strip a month later and you still smell it. It's just an amazing oil. It's very expensive, but if you haven't had a chance to experience it, you should, and beware of where you get it because it's usually cut with like 70% phenyl ethyl alcohol or other things. And if you would like it to try it, to get it, I can, if you're a company, I can help you find a source, but I don't, maybe I might be able to help you with some retail, but it's, just beware, okay? Beware of what's out there because it's there's only a little bit produced relatively to other oils, and it's going to become popular, I think, and be even more tapped because I just developed a blend for a very large company that incorporates it, and it's going to be tapping that because of that, tapping the resources because of that. So, Damiana, Damiana. Damiana. Tunera diffusa is the Ternera diffusa is the Latin name.
I have a question.
Where are you?
I'm here. Actually, I have to say that I'm a herbalist, and all the indications you just mentioned, the herb works just fine. You don't need to use the essential oil.
Yes, it is used. Yes.
On nature. So my question is also from the point of view of a herbalist. So I always hear aromatherapists say that the oils oxygenate and they degenerate, and especially the citrus oils. And I scratch my head because in a Chinese medicine where the citrus come from originally, orange peel and mandarin peel is aged on purpose, and it is held that the older it gets, the better the therapeutic effect will be. So if you can have really, really old mandarin or orange peel, then they're the most valuable. Could you explain that?
The actual peel, not the oil.
The actual peel, okay. So it's unbroken.
Right, well,
smell considerably does change.
The peel is going to contain many other components other than its oil. But if it's very old, obviously most of the oil is probably evaporated. So whatever therapeutic properties the peel has are based on other components that never even make it to the essential oil.
There's still a lot of the essential oils in there. They smell very different, and the indications are exactly like what we know, very much digestive. right. support kind of.
So then maybe the aging process is beneficial to the non-essential oil components. And so, and the essential oil component is a minor effect of using the whole peel versus the essential oil. But if you age a citrus essential oil, it's not going to smell good because of the limonene oxide that forms. And it's not going to be, and that is actually can be a highly sensitizing molecule as well.
I'm just wondering why it must be true that each time an oil oxygenates, it therefore must lose its therapeutic value.
I don't know that it necessarily does, but in the case of many monoterpenes, that's what happens. Now, maybe in other, maybe that's why the heavier oils, when they get older, they get better because, and even therapeutically may get better, but many of these oxygenated monoterpenes tend to have sensitizing effects, exaggerated sensitizing effects. So I don't know the full answer to that question.
Okay, thank you. Mm-hmm.
We are out of time. I imagine we could ask many more questions.
Thank you.